When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James, and Salome brought spices so that they may go and anoint him. And very early on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. They had been saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance of the tomb?" When they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled back. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in white robe, sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. But he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has been raised. He is not here. Look, there is a place they laid him. But go, tell his disciples and Peter that he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." So they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them. And they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. Brothers and sisters in Christ, let us rise for our opening Easter hymn, "Christ the Lord is Risen Today." Amen. You may be seated. Good morning, church.
Good morning.
This is the day that the Lord has made. Amen. Amen. Christ is risen. Amen. A couple of announcements before we begin. Just want to welcome, of course, the Beaver County Brass Quintet to our Easter service this morning. They played that extended prelude, and just a, how about another hand for them? What a thank you. Bless you. Also, really quickly, if you are a member of our church council, this Tuesday at 7 p.m., we'll have a in-person council meeting. We've been doing some Zoom meetings, but this one will be in person, so please try to attend that on Tuesday at 7 for members of our council. And also, we will be having a new member service here on the 23rd, I think. Maybe I'm wrong. Let me see. Let me double check. Recognition of new members on the 23rd of this month. So if you'd like to be a member of our congregation, please get in touch with our church office, or you can come see me and I will get you pointed in the right direction. And with that, that is all the announcements we have this morning. So I know you just sat down, but let us rise once again for our hymn of praise, number 310, He Lives. May be seated. Brothers and sisters, at this time I invite you to turn to the portion of our bulletin that has our prayer concerns and joys. There's a long list of names of those that we are just lifting up to the Lord by name.
giving ourselves over to the Holy Spirit, asking the Holy Spirit to come upon these names in a greater way, those that may be struggling with illness or struggling with just the effects of losing loved ones, those that are dealing with maybe some earthquakes in Syria and Turkey, the effects of the railroad derailment, many that can't be here on this holiday, those that are homebound members, as well as those in our military. I invite you to take this list home with you, and in your daily prayers, lift them each individually by name. But at this time, let us just go to silent prayer for these names, and then I will close. So let us pray. Heavenly Father, God of life and death, creation and redemption, to you this day, Lord, we give all the glory. We give thanks, Lord, and praises to your work in Jesus Christ on this wonderfully beautiful Easter morning. On this day, Lord, we possess boundless joy that is known deep within our souls, peace that remains a rock solid foundation, Lord. Peace that says that despite, Lord, the events that trouble us, we know that you are forever among us, that you are risen, and that you are able to withstand any situation or any attack of pain or struggle or fear that come our way. Nothing, Lord, and no one is beyond your care. Not even death itself, Lord, holds any power this day. And for this, Lord, we are so forever grateful and thankful to you. Today, Lord, we celebrate your name. And as we celebrate, Lord, we also seek you in a fuller way. We seek the sound of your presence in our lives. Let us know, Lord, that you are caring and loving and uplifting us always, not only physically, Lord, but also deep within our spirits. May we see you, Lord, in the encounters that we have with others, in the moments of solitude, in the times, Lord, in which we experience great joy, but also, Lord, let us see you in the times of struggle, the times of sorrow. Make us attentive, Lord, to your Spirit in all things. Also, Lord, in the joy of the resurrection this day, Lord, let us also have reverence for this church that has experienced so many Easter mornings. Let us, Lord, be attentive to the past, but also make us alive to the goodness of life today and the renewal, Lord, of our trust that you are opening us up to new ways of life in the future. And as we move into the excitement of that future, Lord, bless us and keep us and let us always seek your glory. And for those, Lord, that are struggling, we ask you to give assurance of healing that you are forever with them. For those that are in need of healing, give hope. Give hope, Lord, to those that are despondent, and feed those, Lord, that may be hungry. Easter joy, Lord, is light in a dark room. a shout in a graveyard, yelling that this is not the end. And today, Lord, we thank you for the resurrection. We thank you for what you have accomplished in Jesus Christ, the one who we praise this day, who has risen this day and also taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
All right. Good morning, everyone. Thanks for joining us today. We're going to be singing Lift High the Cross, and I invite everyone here to join us on the final chorus of Lift High. I will turn and cue you. We'll have the words on the screen. Thank you.
Thank you.
In the early church, back in the early days of the church, in the persecuted church, it was commonplace that on Easter morning, all of those that had gone through the season of Lent, those that were contemplating whether they were going to become Christians or not, would become baptized on Easter morning. And back when the church was persecuted, it was a very serious thing. They had to make sure that they were willing to take on the role of being called Christian, because it could mean their death. So baptism was an extremely important role in the Easter service. And today it is a wonderful treat for us that we will have two baptisms this morning here at New Brighton. So at this time, I'd like to invite up Tyler and his wife Mallory, and also Braylon and Anthony Frazzini, if you could all come forward at this time. Come on. You can walk right down here. Okay. And all of you can follow along either on the screen, or if you want to grab your hymnal, on page 39, it is Baptismal Covenant number 2. You'll be doing a lot of responsive reading, so if you'd like to, or please follow along one way or the other. Brothers and sisters in Christ, through the sacrament of baptism, we are initiated into Christ's holy church. We are incorporated into God's mighty acts of salvation and given new birth through water and the Spirit. All of this is God's gift. It's offered to us without price. Today, Tyler and Mallory present their children, Braylon and Anthony, for holy baptism. Tyler and Mallory, I have a couple questions to ask you. On behalf of the whole church, I ask you now, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sins? If you do, say, I do. Do you accept the freedom and power God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? If you do, say, I do.
I do.
Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior? Put your whole trust in His grace and promise to serve Him as your Lord in union with the church which Christ has opened to people of all nations, ages, and races? If you do, say, I do.
I do.
Amen. Will you nurture your children, Braylon and Anthony, in Christ's holy church, that by your teaching and example they may be guided to accept God's grace for themselves, to profess their grace, their faith openly, and to lead a Christian life? If you will, say, I will.
I will.
I will. Amen. This is for you. Do you, as Christ's body, the church, reaffirm both your rejection of sin and your commitment to Christ? Will you nurture one another in the Christian faith and include these persons now before you in your love and care? Let us join together in professing the Christian faith as contained in the scriptures of the Old and New Testament. Do you believe in God the Father?
I believe in God the Father Almighty.
Do you believe in Jesus Christ?
I believe in Jesus Christ, the only
Do you believe in the Holy Spirit?
I believe
in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Baptist Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Brothers and sisters, on this resurrection morning, I invite you to remember your own baptism, symbolic of a resurrection from death, death to sin, to eternal life in Jesus Christ. Brothers and sisters in Christ, remember your baptism and be thankful. 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 Remember your baptism, Carla, and be thankful. Don't think I'm forgetting you up there. Remember your baptism and be thankful. Remember your baptism. Remember your baptism and be thankful. Remember your baptism and be thankful. Remember your baptism and be thankful, brothers and sisters. Bless you all. Oh, yeah. They get real close. Remember your baptisms and be thankful. Especially you, Gina. Oh, that's so fun. Now for you. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Eternal Father, when nothing existed but chaos, you swept across the dark waters and you brought forth light. In the days of Noah, you saved those on the ark through water. After the flood, you set in the clouds a rainbow. When you saw your people as slaves in Egypt, you led them to freedom through the sea. Their children you brought through the Jordan to the land in which you promised. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Tell of God's mercy each day. In the fullness of time, you sent Jesus, nurtured in the water of a womb. He was baptized by John and anointed by your Spirit. He called his disciples to share in the baptism of his death and resurrection and to make disciples of all nations. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us and bless this gift of water and those who will receive it to wash away their sin, clothe them in righteousness throughout all of their days, that being raised with Christ, they may share in his final victory. Ready, Braylon? Come here. Braylon Frazzini, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Sorry. There you go. May the Lord work within you, that being born through water and the Spirit, you may be a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. Amen. Anthony? All right. Anthony Frazzini, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. May the Lord work within you that being born through water and the Spirit, sorry, you may live with Christ eternally. Brothers and sisters in Christ, it is my joy to welcome our new brother and sister in Christ, Braylon and Anthony Frazzini. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, that by the water and the Holy Spirit, you have placed upon these children the forgiveness of sin and have raised them to new life of grace. We ask you, Lord, to sustain them. Sustain them, Lord, in your Holy Spirit. Give them an inquiring and discerning heart. Give them the courage, Lord, to forever remain faithful to you. And spirits, Lord, that always seek to know you and to love you with joy and wonder all the days of their lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Brothers and sisters in Christ, Braylon and Anthony are ours now. I commend them to your love and care. Do all in your power to increase their faith, confirm them in hope, And never let us commit the sin of allowing them to drift too far from the love of this church. Amen. As we praise God for this family, let us sing together Spirit of the Living God, number 393. Morning's offering. Let us rise.
Will you pray with me? Heavenly Lord, we thank you for this day for resurrection. We rejoice in Christ as the first fruits of all that you have made available to us. As you offered Christ to the world, so we would offer ourselves as well. May we, along with our gifts, testify this day to the good news of your forgiving love and empowering acceptance through that which we give. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Will you remain standing for the reading of the gospel reading from John chapter 20, verses 1 through 18. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Then Peter and the other disciple set out and went toward the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down to look in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, following him, and went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, who reached the tomb first, also went in, and he saw and believed, for as yet they did not understand the scripture that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples returned to their homes. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and the other at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." When she had said this, She turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you looking for?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." He turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord," and she told them that he had said these things to her. This is the words of God for the meaning of God.
Thanks be to God.
Amen. You may be seated.
Bible opens with these words, familiar words. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was a formless void and darkness covered the face of the deep. While a wind from God swept over the face of the waters, God breathed over the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. A combination of God's breath and God's word, his intellect and his power, produces the first light. And then he separates the light from the darkness. And from that moment on, God's presence has been identified with light. You see, darkness and light are expressive symbolic words in the Hebrew language. Darkness in Scripture evokes everything that is anti-God. Darkness is compared to the wicked in Proverbs 2:13. It's compared to judgment in Exodus 10:21, and to death in Psalms 88:12. In contrast to that, light is the first of the Creator's work. They are brushstrokes of God's divine work in a world that exists in darkness and chaos without God's light. While light is not itself divine, light is often used metaphorically for life, as in Psalms 56:13. "For you have delivered my soul from death and my feet from falling, so that I may walk before God in the light of life." You see, light is a metaphor for so many things in the Scriptures. Light is a metaphor for salvation in Isaiah 9:2. The commandments in Proverbs 6:23, the divine presence of God in Exodus 10:23. And as we just went over, in the first creative act, God saw that light was good. It is goodness in Genesis 1:3. And then finally, light is symbol of God's promises to us in the beauty of a rainbow in Genesis 9:8. Which is reflected light, light that is broken up to reveal its spectacular inner beauty. For ancient peoples, and maybe for all peoples from all time, God is the fulfillment of all that is light. And the antithesis of God is all that is dark. Without God, there is no light. There is only darkness in the creation until God brought forth light. However, there was a second time in creation when it became dark, dark with the absence of God. The Gospels tell us that as Jesus hung on the cross on Friday, though it was midday, darkness beset the whole world, beset the whole land for 3 hours. And we don't know exactly what occurred there. Historically, was the entire earth plunged into darkness or not? Perhaps. After all, the earth was literally killing God, and God is light. And without light, it is dark. But it was a darkness then with more than just a literal darkness. What happened on Good Friday triggered the darkness of separation from God's light, darkness that comes with things like godlessness and hatred and paranoia and fear and misguided religion and cruelty and idolatry and ideology and violence. This is the most blinding darkness of all. Where was God that day? Or maybe better words would be, what would be God's response to this darkness? Well, in the beginning, God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. The Easter reading from the Gospel of John this morning tells the story of Mary Magdalene going to the tomb of Jesus early on the first day of the week, early on Sunday morning. And at the beginning of this scripture, it says, the text says these words, "Early on the first day, while it was still dark," while it was still dark. So many times I've come to this scripture and I just read over those lines thinking they were in all likelihood just meant to be a reference to the time of day or something. But considering what I just said about God being represented by the light, it does open us up to the imagination into a deeper understanding that God could be a part of this text. You see, Mary, as were the other disciples and followers of Jesus at that moment, they were definitely in a deep, deep, dark place the morning of the resurrection. While it was still dark, would have defined them perfectly, because it was dark for them for sure. In the past couple hours, they watched as Jesus was turned on by the crowds who had just in the previous days adored him. They had to stand by as Jesus was beaten and tortured and crucified, and they witnessed his final breaths that were leaving his body. Jesus was dead, and the horrors and the immense sadness of that left them all in a dark, dark place. But there was even a deeper darkness when we think about it that they were dealing with, because you see, Jesus's ministry and the end of it was also the abrupt ending of something that was special and unique as well. You see, it wasn't as if the disciples were living their lives peacefully in an ordinary way, working in their careers, raising their families and things like that, and then out of nowhere something terrible happened to them, like the death of a good friend. No, it was even worse than that, you see. It was even more extreme than that, because you see, they had given up their entire lives to follow Jesus and to be a part of his ministry in the world. They were called by Jesus away from their ordinary lives. They had given it all up for the cause of Christ, and they were going around the nation at this time serving and making a difference in the world. They were making a difference in people's lives. They had experienced amazing things. They had watched as people were transformed and bodies were healed and crippled were walking and blind men were seeing. They watched as thousands were fed with just a small meal, and demons were cast out of people that were suffering from possession. And most incredible of all, they watched as Jesus breathed life into some people who had already dead, like their good friend Lazarus, or even the most incredible, a little girl. You see, the ministry of Jesus was incredible. Their lives had become something special. It had great meaning and purpose. Light was shining everywhere. And then in the blink of an eye, it was finished. It was over. It was dark. The emptiness that they may have felt must have been just incredible. While it was still dark. Yeah, that explains it well. And when I think of the pain that they must have experienced or feeling, I think of something maybe similar to a president dying or something. Imagine the abrupt ending and grief that must have went through the cabinet workers and the aides of President Kennedy the day after he was assassinated. I mean, someone had to go back to their office and pick up the office, pack it all up. You know how lonely that must have been? I mean, the vision of the future that they and others were working for was now over. Their lives seemed to be a part of something great and transformative and wonderful. They seemed to be heading somewhere. They even called it Camelot, remember? I don't remember, but some in the room may. And then it was gone, right? Instantly. In a morning, it was over. Sadness and disappointment, emptiness, shock. I'm sure they were in a dark day as well. Magnify that 100-fold, and maybe you get a glimpse of the darkness felt at the death of Jesus. And we can all relate to this in some way, right? We all have days when we stand when our dreams are in shambles. Careers die. Sickness destroys our bodies. We're forced to move from the homes we love. Spouses don't get to grow old with us because they're taken too soon. And our children have this annoying habit of growing up and moving away, right? Our lives are going along fine, and then before we can blink, we can't even see because it's so dark. However, the words in the scripture, while it was still dark, reveal for us a little glimmer of hope. Because they reveal, just like at the beginning of creation, when it was still dark,
when it was formless and void, God was still. God was still, and God was still at work. God was making a way in the darkness where there was no way. At the tomb, while it was still dark, God was about to create light and life that was beyond all other comprehension. And what this says to us is that if we have doubt about our days, when things get dark in our lives, it means that God has not abandoned us. When the darkness comes upon you, God is still working, bringing new light and life into your existence. Period. The scripture then says that Mary comes to the tomb and the rock that has been covered has been rolled away, that has covered the entrance has been rolled away. She instantly sees this. She goes back to town and gets Peter and John, and they go back to the tomb and they find that there is no death of Jesus, that the darkness in which they have dealt with is in fact not as dark as they think, that Jesus has been resurrected. They find the tomb empty, and instantly a new reality exists. A new dawn of creation has come into our existence. Death now has become life. Darkness is now covered in light once again. Christ the Lord is risen today, and that changes everything for human history. And the largest change that it makes to us is that it changes our perspective on how we all handle the dark days. Now, the resurrection is not just some whistling through the graveyard story. We all know that heartache and pain and endings and death are still a fact of life, and we have to face them. We can't in good conscience deny them. But also, the truth is, Easter and the Christian faith have no life. They have no resurrection apart from the reality of death. There is no resurrection without the first death. There is no light without first standing in the darkness. However, in some ways, it may be good that it is that way, because the light shines brighter, and it means so much more to us once we've experienced dark days. For example, I can't even imagine what it must be like to be a soldier who experienced combat. The horrible terrors of that experience is totally inconceivable to me. My heart and prayers go out to anyone that has been placed in that position of having to endure that kind of terrible darkness. Maybe it's some of you in this room. But for a soldier returning home after a tour in combat, there is another emotion that I have trouble conceiving in my mind. For the soldier returning home, I can't imagine the overwhelming feeling of joy and happiness that first day of returning must have felt like. When I try to visualize what that must have looked like, my mind goes back to some images of some old footage from the early 70s that I've seen from time to time over the years. It's footage of American POW soldiers returning from captivity after many years. In some cases, they had spent many decades or over a decade in a prisoner of war camp. But in this footage that's on the screen right now, they're returning home and they're getting off a plane on the tarmac at a U.S. Air Force base, and the sight of their faces as they get off that plane and catch a glimpse of their families that they haven't seen for so long, the look on their faces is priceless. It is powerful because they are so joyous. They immediately start running across the tarmac and they meet their wives and children for an embrace that must have been an indescribable joy. I don't think any of us in this room could imagine what that must have felt like. You know, I've seen people meet each other at the airport. Sometimes you get a hug, maybe a peck on the cheek, something like that. But it wasn't like this embrace at all. It wasn't like that at all. And you know why these soldiers' embrace was so different? For the obvious. Because they had been through so much, and now it was over. Because they had been to the depths of despair, and now they had hope for a future, because they had stood in the darkest night and now they were standing in the light. And you know what's wonderful about the footage of this day? Is that it happened on one of the sunniest days of the year. It was like there wasn't a cloud in the sky. God said, "Let there be light." And the stone was rolled away. You know, the beloved disciple John in this scripture, he sees the light in the midst of the darkness. He's the only one. The scripture says that he believes instantly upon seeing the bodiless tomb. John instantly believes without full comprehension or explanation. And you know, we all know people like John in our lives, and maybe we all need to be more like John in some way in our lives as well. Maybe that is the point of the whole resurrection story, that we need to believe that God is working in the darkness, that we need to believe in the light even when we can't comprehend it or explain it or even see it. We all know people like this that are in our midst. They are the encouragers that every church has and needs. They are the ones who encourage and believe. They are the ones who believe in people that are struggling with addiction, constantly moving them to recovery and believing with all their hearts that they will succeed in recovery, even when that person has relapsed 10 and 12 times. They are the ones who never give up because they know the risen Christ. They believe in light beyond the darkness. They are the ones that know because of the resurrection, nothing can die with Christ around. Because of the resurrection, nothing dies because Christ is risen. There is no darkness because the light overcomes it. Like rainbows shining beautiful light wherever they are, providing strength, love, devotion, prayer, pointing us all to the promises of God in the rainbow, the promise of light and life for all of us. And maybe we all need to be a little more like them, because Christ is risen today. Brothers and sisters, some of you today may be in darkness, even on this Easter morning. Maybe you're grieving the end of something special. Maybe the shock of it is past, but the scars still suffocate your spirit. If this is the case, let me be like John and encourage you a little bit. Don't feel alone or abandoned. You have not been abandoned by God, because while it was still dark, God was working. He was bringing light into the world. The good news of the empty tomb is that God is working to defeat our sorrows. God is at work to defeat all things that seem like an ending, all things that seem like a struggle or even a death. The resurrection is proof that God has the power over all darkness, and is proof that there really is no death of anything, just new life beyond it. So just hang on as Mary knocks at your door and says, "I have seen the Lord," because God's response, his work in the darkness of Good Friday, was to say a second time, "Let there be light." The resurrection of Jesus is that new light, one which at the end of the day eclipses all other lights, because it says that the Lord promises, represented in the light of the rainbow and all the colors that we see adorned in the Easter flowers at the altar, the Lord promises that he will not let the darkness of any grave claim you. Ever, forever and ever, and unto ages of ages. For the Lord is risen. Christ the Lord is risen. Let's try it one more time. Christ the Lord is risen. Glory be to the Lord our God, Jesus the Christ. Amen. Let us rise for our closing hymn. Let us pray. And may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God, in communion with the Holy Spirit, bless, preserve, and keep all of you, now and forever, and unto ages of ages. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Amen.